Lexus RX was introduced in 1998, 11 years after their first car, the LS400. And that was when Lexus wanted to take on some heavier rivals like BMW and Mercedes. The RX was a luxury branded SUV or crossover that wanted to go up market and immediately became very popular and outsold the already popular ES. It very early secured its spot in this segment, and it has roughly sold 3.5 million of these cars since. And we start off in the fully electric mode. It's fully charged. It says 65 kilometers, and you can reach almost 90 kilometers. And when you turn around like this, this is very nice. You have full view of your car and where the surroundings are and objects and everything. And this is really, really good. And as you turn, it changes direction. Very good, that camera. But this car, it's silky smooth. I like it. It's perfect weight in the steering, and it's very light at the same time that it's got a heavy feeling over it. So it just suits the overall feeling of the car. And I must say that it's one of the most comfortable cars that I've been driving for a while. It's very quiet, and it's mostly quiet because you don't really feel the road. It's like it swallows every little dent and every little sand particle. It's amazing. You know, it runs on 21 inches, but despite that, it's really, really quiet. I just want to drive over some sewer lids and see some uneven surface in the road and a little pothole maybe. Not big potholes, but some potholes. And it's just so quiet. It's like it predicts it when it comes, and it's like it puts another cushion on it. And also driving over some speed bumps, those sharp speed bumps, which are a bit short. Very graceful in its approach. Lexus has really held on to quality and reliability when building their cars. So customer satisfactory support and overall experience is always 10 out of 10. So that says a lot about this brand. And today we stand here with a spanking new 2023 model, the RX 450h Plus. And this one is the first RX with plug-in hybrid technology. There is an RX 350, which is just hybrid, and there is also an RX 500h, a turbo electrified hybrid, which has a little more power and is a bit more on the sportier side. But although this is only 0.3 seconds slower to 100, 6.5 seconds, whereas that is doing it in 6.2 seconds. But all of these cars are fast enough for what they are. This tops out at 200 kilometers an hour. And this sits on the GAK platform, which it shares with its family member, the smaller NX. The engine in this one is a 2.5 liter inline four cylinder, and it's got a battery pack of 18.1 kilowatt hours. So you get an average of 69 kilometers, and combined when you drive in town and everything is 90 kilometers. So it's a bit of a class leader actually. CO2 emissions is only 1.1 to 1.2, so that's very low. Great thing about this is that there is also now a 6.6 kilowatt onboard charger instead of those regular 3.7 kilowatt onboard chargers that you get in most plug-in hybrids. So you tap this one up in 2.5 hours. That's pretty quick. The car weighs 2,240 kilos. So yeah, there's some weight to lug around. So it's extremely relaxed when driving in electric mode. And in this mode, well, here it's the best. It's got some power, you know, this 18.1 kilowatt hour battery. As you push it, well, it gathers speed in a very strong way. You know, it's not frantic. It's just strong enough to pull this plus 2,000 kilo car. Really nice. I pushed it to the limit of the kickdown spot there. And let's see here. If we just do it from zero without kickdown. You know, this is plenty enough of acceleration. Wow, it's almost like a weak, fully electric car in some way. You know, that's enough for this type of car. There's also a sport setting, but then you lose some of that really, really relaxing feel because this electronic adaptive damping works really well when just driving in eco or comfort. These paddles back here, it's a CVT gearbox, so they are just simulated. They don't give you any gear shifting. It's just that it increases the revs of that CVT in some way. So that's just fictional. When pushing it a bit and getting into some corners, I think it feels very responsive. Somewhat, you know, soft, of course, but it reacts rather actively. It's not like it's a sporty, sporty car, but it follows your motion and it really does what you want it to do. So as it rolls into this fifth generation, it's still got the same persona as it has always had. Relaxed, comfortable, quiet, luxurious. And it's even more refined now. You know, I'm enjoying my time just cruising with this car. Regarding its looks, well, you can see from the front that it's an RX. They've done something new with this one. It's got a bit more of a pointy nose. I like how it looks. I think it looks really, really good. Nice grille down here. It looks like an Lexus should. It has this futuristic look about it. Bonnet also raises a bit more here. But when you look at the lights, well, then you definitely see that it's an RX. The color of the car is called Sonic Titanium. And you got this 20 spoke, 21 inch rims, which I think look really elegant. I really adore these rims. Metallic dark color suits the car very, very well in this luxury edition that you got here. And the luxury edition, well, it's mostly packed with everything that you need. So this is the top range model. In profile, you can see that the RX looks, well, they strike again. Really nice with how it follows the window line over here. I really like this part of the car. It feels a bit more tiny than the other ones or the predecessors. It's been softened around the corners somewhat, and that makes it look a bit more small than it is. To be honest, to me, I think that it's lost some of its majestic feel here at the back from the old versions. This new lead strip or lead ramp back here, it looks like the new Bid Atto 3. It feels like they've fallen into this that many cars needs to look the same to sell. And I think that's a shame. It was much more good looking when it only had these individual lights at each side. But now it melts together and it looks like a lot of these Chinese cars, electric cars that has been popping up. I don't like that. It should just have those individual lights here. They could have done something with that. Personal taste, but it doesn't really sit right with me. Compared to its rivals, it's okay. It's not that big. When you load up to this shelf here, you get 461 liters. And if you want to load up to the roof, it is 612 liters. Then of course you can fold the rear seats for some extra space. Get your chargers here. And the subwoofers back here, and also some buttons which you can automatically fold the rear seats. So nothing more than that back here. Let's see about the turning circle. It's all right. So the electric motor, it drives the front wheels, but there is an extra electric motor on the rear axle. And that makes it become all-wheel drive, an electric all-wheel drive. It's powerful. Together with that charged battery, of course. But you need to have that battery recharged, because if you don't, it just becomes an RX 350. Less power and just 200 kilos more of dead weight. So remember to always plug in and charge the car wherever you are. So you use this plug in as much as you can. That's the most efficient way, of course, and that gives you most power. And because it has 6.6 kilowatt of onboard charge, well, it goes rather quick to charge up. But when you really push that accelerator hard. You have that four-cylinder engine. It's not like the six-cylinder engines in some other rivals. They are not as stressed. And that removes some of the luxury feeling that this car has about it, because it feels so stressed. Kicks off. Okay, 0 to 100 in 6.5 seconds. So that's all right. So what you want to do in this car is to drive it in electric mode as often as you can. Get into normal mode or get into eco mode. That's where it sits, and that's where it's most luxurious. So it masks that four-cylinder. But that four-cylinder, it always provides, of course, some recharge rate to the battery. So that's very good. Well, in here, it really takes care of you in a luxury, calm, and beautiful way. Lexus has always provided you with good sound systems. And in this one, there's an added option. It's the Mark Levinson Premium Surround sound system, which sounds just out of this world. You also get this big panoramic roof. And that's also an extra option. So it costs a little more. Oh, now I'm just putting back the whole roof. So you can open the roof. It's just not a panoramic roof. And this is an option you should go for, together with this white, beautiful interior. It looks really creamy, really nice, and it's soft. That is luxury. You don't expect anything else from a Lexus, and you can set them in so many directions. And the thing about the buttons for the electric seats is that they're thick, they're big, and they just do what you want. You just find them, they're at your fingertips. Dark bamboo inlays here, which takes it to another premium level. It goes very well together with this black leather, this white, and it's just an elegant cabin. The look and the colors are just great. So the Mark Levinson and this panoramic roof, together they cost, as an option, 30,800 Swedish crowns. So what is that? About 3,000 euros. So this car, with the luxury trim and with these added panoramic and Mark Levinson, cost 929,300 Swedish crowns, around 90,000 euros. And the base price for the car is 898,500 Swedish crowns. Yeah, a little under 90,000 euros. I like this one. You push it and you open the door, because as you push it, you press the door. In other cars, you pull that hinge, or when you open the door, and then you open with your elbow or something. But here, you push it with arm strength at the same time as you push the button. I like that. It works really well. So I like how it looks. It's not that wow factor over everything. It just looks good design-wise. The buttons, they are big. It feels a bit like Toyota. They're a bit chubby. They're not very super delicate, not flimsy in any way. They just give you a very good premium feel when pushing them. You also got this head-up display. It's elegant in an unpretentious way. And that's Toyota and Lexus. Always been like that. It's just functionality. But the feeling in the buttons, well, it's just great. It's not any flimsy feeling or anything. You get this little trackpad here, which works rather good. You swipe around it and you get that in the head-up display of how you want to set your lane assist, how you want to set your cruise control. On this side, you got the media station and how you turn the volume up and down. A lot of settings. This cluster here gives you all the information that you need. You get some of this very popular nowadays, this piano polished looking plastics here. I don't like that really, you know. You could have just had some different type of plastic, which is a bit matte or something, but don't care about that. You got some storage all around. You got your inputs for charging. You can charge your phone there on that induction plate. This is something that is attention to detail. When you sit here as a passenger, you can push this button and it opens up your way. And if I want to open it, well, it opens my way. That is really, really convenient and nice. And that is luxury in a very practical way. The lining up here, very soft, white, beautiful color. So everything is very lit up in here. It's very light, it's very fresh. This little gear stick, well, it's very, very small to not be intrusive in any way. Very elegantly designed. The 14-inch screen here, it responds very quickly. You don't get the feeling when you push it like it's a little vibration or some sound. Maybe you can set that, I don't know. But in here you get all the information. It's very clearly displayed. You got Android Auto, you got Apple CarPlay, and you can also download this Lexus Link app. And there, by your phone, you can preheat or cool the cabin before departure. And you can also get some coaching of how to drive more efficient. So that's pretty good. You can look at what routes you've been doing. Yeah, all of these are, it's not that very new. You see that in many cars, but it's rather good to have. You get cooling in your seats, you get heat in your seats, and the graphics are very good. Now they've stepped up a bit, because in earlier Lexuses and Toyotas, even though they were brand new, took some time before the graphics became a bit better. But it's surely a new processor here, and it works a lot faster. So just touching everything here makes you feel good. Premium. Ooh, back seat. Ooh. Well, it feels like you step into a rather high seating position. Of course, what you get is very good support for your knees if you stretch them out. The base seat is rather long. The seats, they are very comfortable. They're very soft. And you can recline this. So when you go for longer journeys, you can have yourself a little nap. That's very good. Cup holders here and some storage here. And of course, this big roof that gets all the light in, that is good as well. And if you want to adjust this seat here, you do that on these buttons. You want to get some more space here. But here is a little menu. Heated seats, you get cooled seats, and you get two USB-C charging points. It's a joy. It's a good car. It really stated that it was one of the first to take this part as a crossover SUV luxury car. And it still keeps that very high degree of dignity when it comes to perfection. So Lexus has worked really hard to refine this even more. Thicker glass, better isolation. And you can notice that when you drive at higher speeds, at motorway speeds, it's very, very quiet. The previous model to this one was among the very best in its class. So they really stepped up. It's a quiet car, it's a comfortable car, and it's a luxurious car. You got everything you need. And its motto of keeping you rested as you get to your destination, well, I think we can vow for that. The RX 500H, well, that might be the more sporty choice for the drivers that want to be a bit more engaged in their driving. But I don't think that that will, you know, they're more hardcore SUVs than that one. 371 horsepower, yeah, sure. But you know, this is enough. You shouldn't be driving super active in these cars. You should just float around, sit high, look out, enjoy the interior and the quality feel of it, and be efficient. This adaptive damping, well, it gives you some off-road capability. You push this gravel or off-road button here, and I think it might get a bit softer or something, and how it works with the electric four-wheel drive when driving a little off-road on some gravel roads or a bit more uneven road. Something that is a bit of shame, that in the last one there was this Plus version. This is called Plus as well. I think that was called Plus. And what you get in that one is a third row, so you can fit 7 people in here. But that is not available anymore, so that's a bit on the downside. Plus is also this new infotainment system. Looks really crystal clear, good graphics. It's sharp, it's a lot quicker now, so you maneuver it much, much faster. I really like that. The knobs, good feel in them as you change your temperature. The volume knob here, great feel in that one. You got some physical buttons here, and everything is well laid out. It can feel a bit too much, but I think that they've cleaned up a little more than in previous models. It's not as cluttery as it was before. So you orientate here in a very good way. Well, then the performance, it's good. The performance is okay, but you need to have it charged. But getting into that engaged mode, you know, pushing it, and it's not super duper fun. Also a very good feel when you put your hand in this little pocket here when you should open the door. It's like it's rubbery. It's not plastic or anything, so some attention to detail there. And some cloth in the bottom, like that. This is something that we've seen before, where you change your rear view mirror from connected to the rear view camera, and then you can get it to being normal. Something is strange sometimes if you're not used to it, because it feels like it's a different spectrum. Now I'm a bit used to it, but in the beginning it took me some time. So I was struggling of knowing, should I have it in a classical way or should I have it in this new modern digital way? So that four-cylinder engine, well, it struggles. So that lowers the grade a bit. It doesn't feel that grown up. A bit more muscular, mid-tone muscular, if you would have a six-cylinder engine.